Now I have perhaps the most important interview that we've ever done on the Young Turks. Dogan Uygur, my dad. Okay. Now, I know this is a little self-indulgent, but my dad is obviously a pivotal person in my life. But much more importantly than that, I think he has a really interesting story to tell about the American dream. And partly why I became a progressive and why we started the Young Turks in the first place. Just, you know, young progressives looking to overthrow the established system. So I've told parts of that story before, but I wanted to get you on here to tell the full story of your life.
Okay, okay.
So, Dad, normally I would call you Baba, but I'll go with Dad here.
Dad.
Okay. When were you born and under what circumstances?
I was born in 1937 in a small town in the southern Turkey. My birthday, my mother told me when the black grapes are ripe to eat that I was born. So, but I somehow the guy who's putting on the registry put 1/1/1937. Mm-hmm. So even though I was born in the summer, maybe July, end of July, maybe beginning of August, something.
Okay, so this is old school when. Your birthday is the summer grape picking season.
Yes.
That's it.
Yep.
There's no date on it. You don't know what the date is.
No.
And then your, you know, birth certificate says January 1st because they're like, ah, I'm not going to write black grape season. Okay, I'm going to write, you know, 1/1/37. So you're born in the year 1937. You don't even know what date exactly.
No.
And back then, were there birthday celebrations? Did people have cake?
No, not at all.
Did anybody know their actual birthday?
Well, some people in every household has a Quran. In the Quran, inside the first page, when you open it, it's an empty page.
Uh-huh.
And they used to, some of the little bit intellectual people, and they wrote the date of the name of the kid.
Uh-huh.
And that's the only place you will sign. Some of the other people who are lesser educated, lesser well-to-do, they didn't care really one way or other.
I love that the mark of an intellectual back then was, oh, look, get a load of this guy. He knows the date that his son was born. Whoa, highfalutin, ivory tower.
That's right, yeah.
Okay, other people nobody got time to figure out when you were born.
No.
We were busy picking grapes.
That's it. Or olive, or whatever might be the case.
Right. Now, quick side note there. You guys are picking grapes. Did you make wine with the grapes?
No. We had a wine factory in the town, but yes,
even though obviously the town is predominantly Muslim.
Yes, yes.
Uh-huh.
But yet with the grapes, we did many different things. We crushed them and we drained the juice, and we made into like a heavier flute that we use for as a sweet.
Oh, okay. And you would use it as something that would sweeten other foods.
Yes, sweetening other foods.
I got you. I like that with Turks, even the grapes, they must be crushed. No, to be fair, everybody crushes the grapes to make wine, etc.
And then there are other ways we used to make the grape paste, but very liquid. And then we put on the string all the... what do you call that thing?
The nuts? Is
nuts,
that?
Yes.
Oh, nuts. I remember that. And it's on a string, and you pull it out.
Yeah.
And yeah, right. So, and we talked about this in a post game once for the members, but for everybody here. Just quickly, you had to make all your food, right?
Yes.
There was no refrigerator in your house?
No. Right. Daily we make it and we eat it, or maybe next morning or the next lunchtime, and after that you have to make it new one.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
So, okay, you're born 1937, and people are busy picking grapes, et cetera. Your dad passed away when you were really young. How young were you?
8 months old. I was 8 months old. My brother was about maybe 6 years old.
So does your brother remember your dad?
Very vaguely. I don't think he really recalled all the things, yeah.
And your dad, when he passed away, he had a lot of medical bills, right?
Yes. And at that time in Turkey, one American dollar was something like 75 Turkish kurush, less than one Turkish lira. Mm-hmm. And that time, my dad passed away and left about 850 Turkish liras of loan that we collected from uncles and all the other relatives. And my mother, on the long time working on the different fields and producing enough, harvesting different things, and we slowly paid off that debt.
So I once did the conversion, it was tens of thousands of dollars in current dollars.
Yes.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
And you guys were not rich. And
no.
So you grew up without a dad in this situation. Let's talk about the different levels of society there, because I find that really interesting. So first of all, there are villages, towns, and cities.
Yes.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
So you guys were not in a village, you were not in a big city, you were in a town.
Yes, small town. When I was a young boy, it was about 25,000 to 30,000 people were living in the Kilis.
Oh, that's not bad. Yeah. 25,000 to 30,000, that's pretty significant.
Yes, yes.
How many people would live in a village?
Village is usually a couple hundred people. Maybe in some big villages might have about 1,000 people.
Okay. And so then there are different, honestly, classes, like lower class, middle class, upper class. You guys were not in the upper class. Were you middle class at the time or not really?
Well, we were, for example, my uncle, Hussein A., uh-huh. My mother's brother, older brother, he bought a couple properties and he did some kind of commercial activities when he was young. And he became a known as an ağa. Ağa means, you know, somebody who has some properties and a respected person. And so there are those kind of people. My uncles were just about same, maybe lesser amount of known people. But my mother's brother, Hussein A, was really well known in Kilis.
So, okay, but most important thing is, if I don't know if this is true, I think, is whether you own land or not, right?
Well, we did own land, but it was really funny. And our town was right in the center, and our properties, a very small patch of piece of land in 1 mile away from the center of town, another 20 olive trees in another 2 miles away, and we had a wine yard, mm-hmm. and wine grease trees. So you have to go 3-4 miles to get there.
So here you, I am growing up thinking you guys didn't have any money, when in fact you were running vineyards.
But all the smaller properties, and we didn't have any transportation, we didn't have donkeys, we didn't have nothing, horses, nothing. And so we had to farm out to other people to do some of the taking care of things, and we just try to manage, and we go with them and make sure that they work, and then we are able to pay them. And so it was a very, very hard to make a living that way. If all those properties were in one location, it would be a lot easier for us.
So there were the wealthy families, and my mom actually came from one of the wealthier families.
Yeah.
They had more land, and it was substantial,
yes.
And you would have people work the land for
yes.
you,
yes.
right?
Yes. Yes.
So like my grandfather on my mom's side never went and worked the land, right? As far as I know. But I don't know. Do you know if he worked the land at all?
Yes, yes, they did.
Oh,
they
he did too.
Yes, yeah,
okay, because
yes.
My grandfather on my mom's side became a dentist and was a professional eventually.
From that side, yes, they have large properties in what now become Syria, in the southern part of Kilis, and they had a very large piece of land because Ottoman Empire, when you work in the state. After you retired, they give you a certain part of the one town and go there and you own that very large piece of land and becomes your retirement.
Right.
Payment.
So on my mom's side, that there's stories of how that came all the way from Yavaş Şahin Pasha, who was the admiral of the Ottoman army when they conquered Istanbul. So that's a 500-year history.
That's right.
Right?
Yeah.
And when you are part of an important part of the empire, you get big pieces of land.
Yes.
and other people worked the land generally. It's interesting, after World War I, they draw the line between Turkey and Syria.
Yeah.
Their land winds up mostly on the Syrian side.
They did go and get some income from there, some other, a long time. But after Syria became really controlled by the Assad's father and other people, and then slowly they lost the control of that piece of land.
Right.
But that the person who came to Kilis from Istanbul, Süleyman Çelebi, we don't know how many generation after the Yavaşça Şahin Paşa, and he came first time to Kilis.
Right.
And that's his people, your mother's side, are coming from.
Right. So so there's the wealthy folks like that, and then there are the people who have no land at all.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So maybe they're in one of the villages, or they're in your town. What do they do? How do they live?
They work, people like us, or the even larger landowners, daily they go to work in their field, and they do construction work and buildings and houses and other things, and they do cleaning jobs on the streets, and you know, there are a lot of little jobs that, then some of them has little shops, they sell groceries, and some of them are butchers, some of them are
merchants.
Mm-hmm.
I get it. And so for you guys, you're at the bottom rung of landowners. You have a tiny little bit of land, and it's a real pain to get to. You have a little bit of land, but you don't even own a donkey. You don't own a refrigerator. You don't have electricity in your house.
No.
You don't have anything, right? Yeah. And you're saddled with these tens of thousands of dollars of debts in today's money.
Yeah, we have to pay,
Right. So you're chipping away at this. At what point do you realize, I got to get out of here?
Well, I think it was about maybe I was 12 or 13 or maybe 15. I don't remember exactly. My brother and my mother was urging me to do certain household chores.
Uh-huh.
And I was always trying to get away.
Now I know where I get it from. Okay.
Yes. And my brother one day really beat me up.
Uh-huh.
And then he sat me down and he started talking to me. He said, look, this is our situation and we don't have a father. We don't have other means of making money. And unless we really work together, help each other and make the most out of this, what we have, and then study very hard and become professional, doctor, engineer, whatever might be the case, and then we can get out of this life, so we can provide better life for ourselves and our families.
You remember how old you were about then?
Like I said, around 14, 15 maybe, that, or maybe 13, and those range.
And how did he know? I mean, did everybody in town know, hey, there's, you can get a free education if you score well in the exam?
Yes.
So everybody in the town knows that. Why isn't everybody applying?
Well, I don't know. My brother was first in the my mother's side and my father's side, first one to go to university, college, and educate.
Mm-hmm.
And then I follow him and the other kids after us. Right now, almost every single family youngster is in either on the college or they graduated.
Well, that makes sense. I mean, they see your example, right?
Yes.
And
yes.
My uncle became a doctor. You became a mechanical engineer. And so then you're not tilling the land anymore. And, you know, again, we talked about it in a post game. You should check out if you remember about how you separate the wheat from the chaff, and you got to throw it up into the sky, and you're covered with dirt, and it's super hot, and this is not an easy job, and you got to get up at 3-4 in the morning and walk there without a donkey. You don't know how important the donkeys were back then, right?
Yep.
So so you guys figure it out, and at that point, what, you just started studying a lot harder, or what happened?
When I was in the second year in middle school, I wake up because first semester I got a very bad grades.
Mm-hmm.
And I look at my report card. I said, if I follow this way, I'm in deep shit. So I have to do something better than what I'm doing. And after second term, and I start to work really well, and I find out that mathematics is so easy once you understand the basics of it.
Hmm.
Yes, and that really gave me first impulse for the going for engineering. Once I start to study mathematics and I become really good, and my teacher couldn't believe his eyes when said, when I was getting 0, 1, or 2 in an exam, I start to get 7, 8, 9, 10, and he says, "What's going on? Did you really copy from some of your friends?"
And how high did you get have to score on the exams to get the free education?
It's for, oh, exam. First of all, primary schools up until the high school included was completely free. And for getting into better college, which government owned most of the college that time, and I want to go to Technical University of Istanbul, which it was the really premier educational institution in Turkey at that time. And we, I think, applied something like 3,000 or 3,600 students entered the examination. They only accepted 500. So I was one of them in my time.
I got you. So, it, first of all, it's interesting that in all of Turkey back then, what year is that when you're applying for college?
1957.
In 1957, in all of Turkey, only 3,600 kids applied to go to the best engineering school
yes.
In the country.
Yes.
And but they only took 500, so 2,900 didn't make it.
Yes.
Went back home, back to the black grapes and the olives
whatever
and,
they did,
and the wheat and the chaff. And
but they got, some of them, they applied to other schools, like the law school and medical school and many other schools that was available. But it wasn't widespread like it is today.
Okay, now before we go to the college years, I wanted to ask you two more things about when you're back in Kilis. And then for some of your high school, you went to Gaziantep, which is the larger city near Kilis,
you know,
right?
My hometown, we didn't have, first of all, my brother was studying in a high school in the Gaziantep, next big town. And so we immigrated. To, we went to Gaziantep. We 3 years, we stayed there. I went. I finished the primary school in Gaziantep. And then once my brother graduated and went to university, we came back to Kilis again. In 3 years, I went to middle school. And after 1953, I went to high school in Gaziantep again on my own, alone. I rented a small room in somebody else's house, and I lived alone, and I went to school, came back and studied, and I went to school.
See, I don't know that part. How old were you when you were doing that?
15, 15 to 18.
So they let you go to another town? There's, I'm pretty sure you didn't have a cell phone to call home every night. Did you have any phone at all?
No, no.
How
no.
do you communicate? So you leave for months at a time?
Yeah.
And nobody ever hears from you back home? And
well, there are friends and people are going and coming between Kilis and Gaziantep.
So you tell them, hey, if you're going back to Kilis, tell my mom I'm alive.
No, beside that, my mother cooked the food and put in the big container on top of each other and gives to one of the guy who operates the bus between my hometown and Gaziantep. And so on the way, they when they come from Kilis to, into the Gaziantep, our school, high school, was right in the entrance area. They leave my food on the reception part of the school, and they go. So I go pick up that, and I eat that.
So how often did that happen?
Almost once a week at least.
Oh, and okay. Because I was going to say, how do you eat? You're in a house by a room by yourself. You don't have a kitchen. You don't have anything. What do you
I
do?
I get the bread from the bakery and I a little bit of cheese and some other very rudimentary things that
so
I
So no wonder you don't care about food. Like, because I'm always trying to get you to go to good restaurants or whatever. You for 3 years, you're eating basically cheese and bread. Sitting there by yourself, and every once in a while, obviously, your mom sends you the food.
Yeah,
that's amazing. So back then, sending a 15-year-old by himself to live in an apartment by himself in a different city, that's life.
Yeah. Well, there's no other solution. I mean, I had to go be on my own.
Yeah.
1 year, the last year, I stayed in the dormitory with the other kids.
Okay, but 2 years, that's fancy.
It was very fancy.
Had the time of your life, huh?
We had a really great time. We didn't have too much, but we had good friends from my hometown, and we enjoyed. And I used to imitate all the Turkish movie stars, and that was a favorite of all the friends. And they begged me to play some of the scene from the Turkish films.
Well, so that was one of the things I was going to ask you about those years. So you were an actor briefly.
Well, in one year, last year in middle school, we played a theater, okay, and I took a part on that. And everybody says I was really fabulous, but I don't know, and maybe I felt that way. And so I like it. And beside that, first time I was about 7 years old or so, and a group of students from the Gaziantep High School, they came and they played a play in Kilis. I went by myself, and as soon as I start to see this theater, I was mesmerized. I never seen anything that's what I like. And I decided I'm going to be artist. I'm going to be in movies. But my brother convinced me not to do it.
Because it was too impractical?
Yes.
So go be an engineer. Let's get out of this farm.
And then high school last year, and we had another play. And I again took part of it. And I was the star of that one too.
Oh, look at this. Okay. And after all these years, you're finally on air.
That's it.
So, you know, it's funny because it seems so incongruous to me that, you know, here you are getting up at 3, 4 in the morning, going to your olive farm, small patch of land, working that. I mean, you said in the vineyard you had, what, 20 trees or something?
No, or vineyard was about 350
stalks or whatever they're called.
Yeah, yeah.
Right, in another patch you had 20 trees of something.
20 trees of olive.
Right, okay, so you got the 20 olive trees and you got this and that. And then meanwhile, you're going to act. I don't know, I feel like you wouldn't have had the luxury to act, but,
well,
but you guys did anyway.
When you are in the school and in the confine of the school, you are acting, you learn how to do it because our teacher was really good. He taught us what to do and how to do it.
Yeah, I don't know. I guess I imagine that they wouldn't have, when you first told me that story a while back, I was really surprised. That, like, why bother with acting? We got to learn math and reading and history and move on with our lives. We don't have time for nonsense acting.
No.
But even back then, they taught you acting.
Yeah, yeah.
So all the way back in the 1940s,
well, 50s. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. So speaking of which, did that work with the girls?
Yeah, in some of the plays, and there were girls, yeah.
No, no, I mean, you being the top actor in these plays, were the girls impressed by that?
I don't really know. Those days, it wasn't like United States that the boys and girls, they go date or they really be a friend or anything like that. Even though if you sympathize with some of the girls or the girls sympathize for you, and except with once in a while looking at each other, you wouldn't have the chance of even holding her hand.
So it's obviously not co-ed education. Your dorm is all guys, your school is all guys?
Yeah.
Okay.
No, no, no. School, we were mixed. And
girls. Oh, the schools are mixed, yeah, girls and guys.
Yeah.
But no, you're not giving your varsity jacket to anybody.
No.
There's no prom.
No, no, nothing, no, okay. Nothing.
Okay, but every once in a while, you guys will steal a glance at one another.
And so, then the gossip goes around. You know, Dogan is, you know, looking to this girl, and this she's really hot for him or something like that.
This is going to get a little awkward. Did you ever kiss any girls while you were still in Kilis or Gaziantep?
Well, when I was in Gaziantep primary school, there was a Jewish girl. Her name was Leila. And she had a very curly hair and blonde hair. And I was very fat, and my cheeks were really red. I was running around and playing. And she came, and all of a sudden, she kissed me from my cheek. And I love it. But yet, a couple of months later, her family moved to Istanbul, and I lost contact with her. I don't know where she is right now.
Well, that could have been a beautiful Jewish-Muslim relationship, you know, back then, blooming. I guess I'm glad it didn't happen because I wouldn't be around if it did. But that's a tough break for you.
Yes.
The one girl that actually kisses you on the cheek, and then they moved away.
But her family was very rich, I guess. That's the time when they were starting to go to Israel.
Uh-huh. Oh, so did they go to Israel?
Yes. I don't know. They went to Istanbul, but I don't know if they went to Israel or they stayed in Istanbul or Tehran. Uh-huh. I don't know.
And you never found her again?
No.
Okay. All right. Well, if you're watching, okay, my dad still remembers. Okay. Whoever you are, Layla, out there. Okay. So, but you never kissed a girl on the lips while you were in your hometown?
No.
No. Okay. Did any of the guys, was there ever like, oh my God, Ahmed kissed the girl, it was amazing.
Once in a while, some gossip goes around, but very rarely, if any, very, very difficult.
But that would have been a big scandal.
Yes, big scandal.
Okay, all right, I got you. And where would they have done it anyway?
Well, I was teaching one of the girls younger than me mathematics on the summer months, and my friends find out about that, and they come front of their door, they start screaming, Dogan, are you doing all right? That's crazy.
Because they don't want any shenanigans
yes.
in there. Okay, I got you. All right, so so now you get into college. Is your mom ecstatic at that point?
My mom really didn't realize where we are going. And she says, okay, go to, if you want to go. But she was always trying to push us to help her. Because she was really carrying all the load, everything. When we go to school and she's alone.
That's what I was going to ask you. If you're in your dorm or wherever you are in that apartment in Gaziantep, my uncle's already trying to become a doctor, how the hell is she farming the land?
Well, she finds other people and...
But she's got to pay them. You're making this much money anyway and you've got all the debt.
Yeah.
So that all that she's carrying on
yes,
her back.
Yes.
Right.
But my mother, maybe my best luck, is my mother and my brother. My mother had such a logical person, and she didn't go to high school or any kind of, just went to regular religious school. Mm-hmm. And her brother instructed her teacher not to teach her writing because he was afraid that she might write letter to her boyfriend, which she never had.
Okay, Jesus. But despite that lack of education, people in the neighborhood used to come to her. She was kind of like an informal
judge.
Judge Judy of Kilis.
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay, that's great. And your brother obviously pushed you to. So he was very excited, I'm sure, when you got in a good school.
Yes, yes, yeah. definitely.
Yeah. So when you go to Istanbul, is that the first time you're in Istanbul or had you visited there before?
No, first time.
So this is now, compared to where you grew up, a giant city.
Yes. Yes.
Right? And yes. were you like, what is this?
Yes. My uncle's wife, Hatice Yenge, came to pick me up from the train station.
Mm-hmm.
And I was amazed looking around and huge big train station. And then we boarded the ship, that ferry, to the other side, European side of the Istanbul. And so I was amazed. I was mesmerized. I said, what a beautiful.
And that was the first time you were ever on a ship, on a boat?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So at that point, you'd already listened to radio because your uncle had a radio.
Yes, yes.
Right?
Yes, yeah.
But you've never seen a TV.
No.
You've never driven a car.
No.
Had you ever ridden in a car?
Yes, of course. I was going and coming back to
Gaziantep in the bus.
Yes.
Right. Yeah. Of course. Okay. And so you get there, and they go, okay, where'd you stay? Did they have a dorm?
No, Refik abi, which it is her son, uh-huh. and my uncle's son,
uh-huh.
and I stayed in their house.
And they were generous, and they let you stay in their house.
I am so grateful to them, because we didn't have the money, and I was alone in a big city, and I didn't know where to go, what to do. And that was the greatest thing that had happened to me.
So Hillary Clinton's book was It Takes a Village, right? One of her books.
Yeah, yeah.
In your case, it was literal. It took a village of family and friends that
yes,
you knew.
Yes, yes,
because you had no money, so you couldn't have afforded an apartment in Istanbul.
Not
no
at
way.
Not
right?
At all. Not at
and
all.
Then they probably cooked a lot of your meals.
Yes, definitely.
Without them, there's no way you make it,
even though
you have a free education.
I did help them at home and for household work, but just to help. Because the ladies always do the dishes and they do all the cleaning and everything. But as much as I can help, I try to help.
Let me ask you a quick question about religion at this point. Are you guys, I mean, theoretically for Muslims, you're supposed to pray five times a day?
None of us prayed nothing at all. My mother was very religious, and she went to Hajj, and she...
So she made the pilgrimage to Hajj, which every Muslim is theoretically supposed to do.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
And she used to read the Quran at least three times a year.
Mm-hmm.
But for me, never, never. Only time on the holidays, festivities times, mm-hmm. we have the two holidays, one Ramadan holiday, one Qurban holiday. In those days, first day, morning prayer, we go to Jami, mm-hmm. mosque. That's it.
Mm-hmm. So the only time you ever went to mosque is on those two holidays, yes. you'd go in the morning?
Yes.
Okay. How about the rest of the town?
Well, most of the people who are going to school and who little bit understand what's going on was really like us. But there are certain person of the people who didn't go to school, they went to religious schools and things like that. They really go five times a day, and they were more religious people.
And there was no pressure from society,
no.
family, nothing?
No.
Okay, so you didn't pray back then, you're in Istanbul, you're not praying five times a day, not going to the mosque, And so, because to relate to here to the U.S., there's a tradition of everybody goes to church on Sunday.
I know.
Right?
For us, that's nothing.
For you, it wasn't the case.
Yes.
Well, that's interesting.
Because that time, we were still under the Atatürk's revolution.
Uh-huh.
And
so Atatürk, if you guys don't know, is the founder of Turkey.
Yes.
So after the Ottoman Empire loses in World War I, Atatürk forms the Republic of Turkey out of the ashes of the Ottoman Empire.
Yes, yes.
And he's deeply secular.
Yes.
And so that you're living under his revolution,
basically. Those times, it was really Atatürk's people who grew up in that atmosphere. They were fiercely independent, secular, and they didn't teach us anything religious at all.
So Atatürk got rid of the caliphate, because the caliphate used to be with the Ottoman Empire, which was the strongest Muslim empire at the time, and Atatürk said, we're done with that.
Yes.
No more caliphate.
That's it.
And he switched the alphabet from Arabic script to Latin,
Roman alphabet. Yeah,
to the Roman alphabet, and then made everybody have a last name officially, and that's why when you guys picked the last name Uygur.
Yes.
Right. And you did that because the Uyghurs, you thought, had written language or something?
Uyghurs, they told us, and what I read recently, they were the one group of Turkish people, they were more educated than all the others. And all the different Turkish tribes or the state that in Central Asia or Middle East, they were always, Uyghurs were managing their state.
Oh, because they had the education, that's why they were managing the affairs of the state.
Yes, even the Genghis Khan's state and home
officials
and everything, everything was Uyghurs.
Oh, I didn't know that. So that's Genghis Khan in English. His bureaucrats were Uyghurs. So that's good. So. Positive that your family obviously valued education.
Yes.
That's why they picked the last name Uygur.
Well, one of our relatives was a very educated man. He was working for education department. And when this thing happened in 1927, everybody has to have a surname, family name. And our people panic because our last name in my hometown is Molla Habiboğlu.
Uh-huh.
It was very long, very difficult to pronounce for everybody. Uh-huh. And they called him and they said, what are we going to do? He said, well, this is the good people, very educated people. Let's get the Uyghur name.
I like that even back then you guys were like, well, Habiboğlu, it sounds kind of awkward. Let's go in a new direction.
Yes.
Okay, well, I think I'm glad you guys did. So you're back in Istanbul. Nobody's going to mosque. Nobody's doing anything like that. So now I'm going to stick with the girls' theme for a second, okay? Now there are girls everywhere, right? And there's no family around except for your uncles, your cousins.
Well, when I go out, and I'm on my own, and I and most other friends, we used to do, when we going on the street and we see beautiful young girls coming or going next to us, And we slowly approach to them and start to walk with them and say, can we be friends? And most
can
of
we
the,
be friends?
Yeah.
What a line.
Yeah. Most of the time she says, get away, stupid. Uh-huh. And then you keep going, you insist, you uh-huh. insist. And finally she says, what do you want? Okay, that means door is open now. You can.
The door is open. Because they have to say no, in the, yes. because that's it would be outrageous if they were like, hey, how you doing? Sure, let's talk.
Yeah.
Right. I got you. So this is Mediterranean culture.
Yes.
And I used to criticize the Italians because they'd follow the girls around. Hey, how you doing? But it turns out my own dad was doing it.
Yes, yes, yes. And I started to have a girlfriend. Uh-huh. And even though I didn't have a car, I didn't have anything, but I was barely have enough money to take her movies. Uh-huh. That's it. Or most of the time, we sit in the park and talk to each other, hold
so
hands.
Do you remember how old you were the first time you kissed a girl?
Probably, no. You know what? I remember now, when I was in high school in Gaziantep, my landlady's daughter, I kissed.
Ooh, drama!
Yes. Yes.
So how you were in high school at the time?
Yes, rather than 16, 17.
16, okay, look at that, player.
So I was a little bit experienced.
Okay, well, I probably kissed a girl when I was 15 or 16, maybe it's a tie.
Yeah.
So it's not that different in that sense. although we went a little quicker after a while, but anyway. So, okay, you're in the big city, you're doing this, you're getting education, and the kids that are in your college, they're all from all over Turkey, right?
Yes, yes.
And are some of them all poor?
Yes, 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 yes.
And they all like you from
all
whatever town?
I mean, there were some rich kids, mm-hmm. and but very few, but most of us, almost 90%, was really coming from the middle or lower income families.
From all over Turkey, and
yes.
these are the kids who were somehow knew to study hard and were smarter, hardworking enough, and they all from their little towns from all over heard about a free education and got into this college. And when you guys got out, how many of those guys wound up being successful business people?
Well, I think almost half of us really went into business on their own. First, they work one or two companies and they get some experience. And then they start their own company. Mm-hmm. As a matter of fact, I helped two of my friends to start their own business.
Oh, okay. And then they were off to the races and they did.
Yeah, well, one of them is really well to do right now. Other one is not bad. Uh-huh. And because when I finished the military service in Ankara, so I came back to Istanbul, I established my company, International Makina Sanayi, International Machinery Manufacturing.
No, that sounds pretty official.
Yes.
You made that up.
Yes.
Okay. All right.
And so I rented a small office. It's one large room and two small rooms. I took the large room. I bought a beautiful white desk and chair and everything. And those two rooms were empty. And my friends come to see me. I said, if you want to start your business, don't have to pay anything. I'm paying anyway. Come and start.
So I want to get into your business life in 1 second, but back to college for a second. When's the first time you see a television set?
Television set, I think after I came to United States in 1960, wait a minute, I really saw the television on 1961 when I came to United States. I went to Washington, D.C. because my brother is a doctor, helped a lady on the hospital, mm-hmm. and she likes my brother, and she called her as a son, and my brother called her mother, and then she gave me the paper that I'm going to take care of him. That's the reason I got the visa, came to United States, and my she insisted that I come to Washington, D.C. to stay with her. Mm-hmm. So when I come to her house, that's the first time I see the television.
Okay, so in college, in the big city of Istanbul, still never seen a TV set. When's the first time you went to a movie?
Well, movie, even in my hometown, we used to go to movies. Way back when I was even younger, and we had
all. Is it just American movies or American?
Most of them were American movies, but there were some Turkish movies as well.
Any Indian movies?
I don't remember. Indian movie came when we were in high school or something. IMO, something like that. There was some very popular one movie, Indian movie, that was really, really popular in Turkey. I think when I was in high school. Yeah.
And I had heard you guys talk about once that people got married in the
movies,
movie theaters.
Yeah.
Well, so what was the movie theater experience like? I assume no popcorn.
That is really so funny. Bride and groom, they come up and movie screen is there, and in the front there is a place you can sit. There we can put table and the chairs. And it's high from the ground, okay? And then broom and groom, they sit over there. And all the invited people, they sit in the audience.
Uh-huh.
And the film plays. And after finish, they go home.
And that's their wedding?
Yes. So, unbelievable. My uncle's son get married. And at least 3-4 people's wedding, I went there.
Can you imagine that you go to you know, your wedding, and it turns out you happen to hit a crappy movie, right? And you're like, oh, Jesus Christ, you know, we got married to Gili or whatever that thing was, Ishtar.
Yes.
Okay, and people ate at the movie theater?
No.
No? Okay, no, that's it. You just go and that's it.
That was very crazy.
That's funny. Okay, so you get a good education here. Your brother gets that lady that you just explained to get you a visa to mm-hmm. come here because mm-hmm. you're going to go to graduate school.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
So were you already accepted to graduate school in the U.S.?
Yes. I applied to 3 or 4 schools, and University of Maryland accepted me. Stevens Institute of Technology accepted me. And because she was there, so I went there. Because when I came to United States, my brother sent me in a mail a piece of paper, I'm going to New York, please help me. And that much, I didn't know one word of English.
So hold on, you come to graduate school in America, you don't know a word of English.
No.
You arrive with a piece of paper in your hand that says,
I'm going to New York, please help me.
I'm going to New York, please help me.
I show everybody.
You keep showing it to people.
Yeah.
And they're like, okay, go that way, go that way. And what, did they put you on a bus at some point? Or how?
Where?
In from the airport to New York?
No, my brother came to pick me up from JFK. And then I stayed, I think, one night with my brother. Mm-hmm. And then next morning, and he put me on the Greyhound bus mm-hmm. from 42nd Street bus terminal.
Mm-hmm.
I went to, and then call her and tell her that I'm coming with this bus mm-hmm. in this hour. And she came to pick me up. And she was living a little outskirts of Washington, D.C.
Oh, I see. Okay, so once you're here and you do all that. Okay. And so how did you learn English?
Well, I got this book. It was a really good book, How to Speak English, and mm-hmm. in English, not the Turkish, okay? But yet my brother paid my money for my going to course, and I went to Washington, D.C., I think November 23rd. I landed in New York on November 21st, and I went to Washington, D.C. 23rd. I think a couple of days later, I enrolled this English course
mm-hmm.
in center of Washington, D.C.
Mm-hmm.
And it was either 2 weeks or 3 weeks. I'm not sure, because I had to start the school on 15th of January,
mm-hmm.
graduate school.
So you've got about 6-7 weeks to learn English.
Yes.
People complain about working hard these days. Or go, learn English in a whole new language.
Yes.
Can you imagine being able to learn Chinese or Russian or whatever in 6-7 weeks? Go.
Right. Okay, so I was studying all day, at least 18 hours a day. And when I was going to the course, English course, and on the way in the bus, I was memorizing all the words.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was really going crazy. I have to learn. I have to learn because I have to go to school.
Mm-hmm.
And when I went to school, I think it was in 1962, either March or February, the there was a gentleman, a foreign student advisor, Dr. Bridges, in University of Maryland. He came to me, he said, Mr. Uygur, if you are available, I'm going to take you to someplace this Saturday night. I said, okay. He come to pick me up from my house. We went to Baltimore American Ladies Association.
Okay.
And I delivered a beautiful speech about Turkey to the Ladies Association.
So on November 21st, you land in America, and by February, you're giving a speech in English.
Maybe March. I don't remember the exact date. But
so, you know, 3-4 months, whatever it is, you're giving a speech in English, and they understood you.
They asked a lot of questions. I answered them all, and it was everybody says it was really very enlightening, and we learned a lot.
And then at some point, you wind up at the White House, right?
Yeah, that's another very funny thing. I still save that invitation. And one day, and I received an invitation, says the it's written in the really gold lettering, and it says President Kennedy and his wife, Jacqueline Kennedy, ask you to honor us with your presence in the White House. I said, somebody is pulling my leg, but I think who knows who I am and how they can invite me for this kind of thing. But then I show a couple of people and said, yeah, that's right. That's not the pulling around, and this is really a thing.
And why now, why had they invited you?
Well, Kennedy was trying to really develop good relationship with the rest of the world. A Peace Corps was developing that time. And Kennedy wants to young people who came from overseas studying all the universities around Washington, he invite everybody, this student from different different schools, to the White House, Rose Garden. And this is good PR and good to have the good feeling for America.
So somebody at University of Maryland knows you're a foreign exchange student or whatever they called you back then. And they say, this guy's a good student, bring him to to the White House, you get this invite.
But I because University of Maryland and the White House is something like at least 45 minutes drive. And there is no direct bus or anything like that. And I was, you know, how am I going to get there? I don't have
a car. You get invited to the White House, you don't even know how to get there, or you don't have any means of getting there. How did you get there? Horse and carriage?
No. that I started talking to different students and this girl.
So now you got a new son. I'm going to the White House. Please help.
No. This girl, there was some undergraduate girl, boys, and I don't know how I was involved with them. And one of the girl, I said, look, I have this invitation from White House, but I don't have any transportation to go to. She said, I have a car. I said, that's it. We are going together.
That's nice. Okay, any kissing there or no?
No.
She was just okay.
No, you see, maybe in my gene or maybe by luck, in that Rose Garden was full of students and a lot of people. All of a sudden, I came face to face with Kennedy.
Oh, wow, that's great.
I shake his hand. He asked me, where are you from? I said, from Turkey. Oh, it's a great country, this and that. Okay.
Did you, was Jackie O there?
Jackie wasn't there, I think, when I come face to face with Kennedy.
Okay, I had forgotten that you actually, so you shook his hand.
Yeah.
Did you think, what a country?
Not only that, I talked to Voice of America. They invite me and they
interview. What are you, Forrest Gump?
I don't know how it happened. You know, all these things are
Dogan Gump.
Interrelated, but it is not. And in Ankara, Ismail Abi was living in an apartment. On the lower floor, there was an old lady. And she said, when I was trying to come to the United States, I was staying with them, okay? And she said, my son is in the United States, and he works for Voice of America. I got his telephone and name when I came to the United States. And then I think, when I was in Washington, D.C., that's right. I called him, and he invited me to his home, and we had a dinner with him, and he said, maybe I should interview you as a foreign student in United States, first 4 months or 3 months, wherever it is. Mm-hmm. And he invited me. I went to the center of Washington, D.C., American Voice of America's center. Mm-hmm. So they interviewed me.
Yeah. So it sounds like America was incredibly welcoming to you.
Yes, it was very welcoming. And as a matter of fact, when we get married with your mother, and I saw a notice on the bulletin board says, foreign student, if you want to go to, you know, in your vacation someplace, and we will find you families that will entertain you, or they will keep you in their home. Mm-hmm. And so I got the names, and I called, sent them a letter, and then we had the vacation for, Thanksgiving vacation, okay? Mm-hmm. And we, I took my young bride, and we ride down to Miami.
Uh-huh.
In Miami, we stayed one very rich architect's home, mm-hmm. beautiful estate, and they have a little guest house on the behind the home.
Mm-hmm.
And we had a great time there, and then they find it made another arrangement with the very other rich and well-to-do family, invite us for Thanksgiving dinner.
So back then, rich families would say, oh, foreign exchange students,
yeah.
a young Muslim couple,
yeah.
great, come down and stay with me
yeah.
for Thanksgiving.
Yep.
And they'd invite you to their house, and then you'd get to stay. You must have thought this was the greatest country on earth.
Yes, I was so delighted to see, especially that very rich family's home. It was right on the lake, and it was huge, big house. And first time I see the English style, you know, pipe in his hand.
Uh-huh.
And
really
lady,
old school.
Yeah, lady yeah. is really very long dress and everything. And after dinner, they brought a plate of different cheeses. Uh-huh. I said, what the hell is cheeses doing here?
Uh-huh.
And I understand later that cheese is really eaten after the dinner in order to help your digestion.
Oh, for the sophisticated people.
Yes.
Of course, of course. Okay. So now you're getting to experience this wonderful part of America, and that's no wonder you love America,
yes,
right?
Yes.
Right? So, and honestly, so let's pause for a second for a political note here. Are you saddened at how much the country has changed today?
Very much so, yes.
Yeah,
yes.
And not in a positive way, unfortunately.
No. You know, in my view, it was really heaven and earth. That much I love it.
Mm-hmm.
And I was, you know, working for the Stevens Institute of Technology. I was able to buy my brand new car, Chevrolet,
mm-hmm.
Corvette. No, Corvair, not Corvette. Oh. Corvette is the sport car,
yeah.
but Corvair is the one boxy small car.
Okay, all right, that makes more sense.
$2,100, I paid cash.
How proud were you that day?
Oh.
Okay, so we'll get to your jobs in a second. But my uncle, how did he know to come to America? I mean, it's one thing, okay, you heard about an education and you guys go to the big city of Istanbul.
But
how about America? How did he know about that?
Probably from medical school. Before him, some of the other kids went to America because there was a doctor shortage in the United States that time. And they were bringing in this new graduates, has no experience, out of school, and they were paying them $150 a month.
A month?
Yes.
Wow.
But
and these guys still complaining about wages over
okay,
here.
But they were they were giving them a place to sleep
uh-huh.
in the hospital, and they're giving them three meals a
right.
day, and that's it, and $150 a month, and they were teaching them.
Mm-hmm. So, I mean, if your kid from Turkey is my uncle is, and he doesn't even have an older brother to rely on like yeah. you did, right?
He wrote letters without knowing a single word of English to the United States. He applied maybe 10 different hospitals, and one or two accepted him. And
how does he apply without knowing English?
I made an old application to different universities. I didn't know English either.
So are you guys writing in English or in Turkish?
English.
How are you writing in English if you don't know English?
I go to my professors and my English people, my class who knows English, and I write me this letter, and they write.
Okay. See, that's interesting. In my life, my dad has always told me, just go ask people for help, and they'll give it to you,
yeah.
right? In my experience, that hasn't been the case. But in your experience, whenever you ask people for help, they helped you.
Yes, yes. A lot of people helped me.
In some ways, that's interesting, really interesting. 1950s and 60s, both in Turkey and the U.S., is this magical time.
It is.
Where people are actually helping each other. Yes. There's free education. You've got opportunity.
One of my uncle's wife's friend find me students to teach, high school students. I went to their home and they pay me, and that was a big help.
Mm-hmm. So my uncle hears, okay, they're going to give you $150 a month and they're going to give you food and stuff, and they're going to teach you, you know, even. So he was already a doctor in Turkey,
but
he studied to be a doctor,
yes,
in Turkey.
He graduated, he got his diploma, uh-huh, and then he came to the United States.
Then he came to the United States, and then he becomes a doctor here. He sponsors you eventually,
yes,
et cetera, et cetera. Okay, got you. And he's telling you, this America is unbelievable.
Yes,
you ought to check,
yes,
this out,
yes,
right? Okay, and thank God he did, so we all wind up here. But before, okay, so you get your education here. You went to University of Maryland. Then you transferred to Stevens later in Hoboken. At some point, you got into Columbia, but didn't know you were supposed to go there. Is that right?
No, no, I chicken out. I don't remember why, but I made a big mistake.
Uh-huh.
For a master's degree, I made an application to Columbia. No, the reason maybe I didn't go because I was working in Stevens Institute of Technology, mm-hmm, laboratory, research laboratory, and I was scared that they might, because I was going Stevens that time,
mm-hmm,
okay, if I quit the Stevens and go to Columbia, they might just fire me or something
and
like
that. And you couldn't afford to lose a job.
Yes.
Okay, so at some point, I remember you telling me you had a job in Hoboken selling pots and pans or something?
Well, that's another very interesting thing. And I was teaching students. I was putting a little ad on the newspaper, daily newspaper, for $7 a week.
Ooh, $7 a week.
Yes.
Getting rich. Okay.
Yeah. And then people start to call me.
Uh-huh.
And I said, all science courses, all levels.
Mm-hmm.
I go to people's house and kids are 12 years, 13 years, 14 years, sometimes 18 years old, and I teach them mathematics, physics, chemistry,
mm-hmm,
and $7 an hour. While I'm getting out of the house, they give me a check for $7, or if 2 hours, it's $14.
Oh, you were getting $7 an hour back,
yes,
then?
Yes.
Well, that's pretty damn good.
Yeah.
Okay, all right.
And so I was doing that something like a year or
Why
so.
Why are they hiring you, all these parents, if you barely speak English?
No, that time I learned English. I mean,
oh, by that time, okay, you've learned it and you already are at Stevens.
Yes,
I got
yes,
you.
Yes.
Okay.
And
right.
So I was making money, but I saw an advertisement in the newspaper, you will make a lot of money and come to see us, this and that. It was the other part of the New Jersey. I said, at night they were inviting me to come to see, we are going to have a drink and this, you can meet the people or so many other things. I said, yeah, I have a car. I drove up there and then I went in and I find out that this was pots and pan sales office.
Mm-hmm.
I was ready to get out. The guy, the manager, said, no, just listen to us. Just listen to us. You are not going to lose anything. You came this far just to stay. I did. And he told us how to sell the pots and pans, how much money we will make this and that all this time. At the end, he gave me a suitcase full of pots and pans.
Uh-huh.
I said, I'm a doctoral student and I can't do this. He said, no, you can't do it.
Uh-huh.
I said, okay, let me try it.
Of course.
Okay. They find another person very close to Hoboken and he has a lot of experience. And I went with him, he to teach me how to do it.
Mm-hmm.
After a certain time, he said, okay, you are on your own. So 1 month, every night after school, after work, I was going door to door trying to sell pots and pans. I couldn't sell anything at all.
Oh, really? I thought the story was going to end with like, oh, I sold it all and
no, no, no. No, no, no. You see, uh-huh, I said myself, if they told me if I sell one first set of pots and pans, uh-huh, and the sample set will be mine.
Oh, I see. Okay.
I said, I'm going to get at least sell one and own this thing. So I keep going. And he told me Saturday, Sundays, don't go anybody. Don't bother everybody.
Uh-huh.
Okay. I said, nah, I'm going to go. Either it was Saturday or Sunday. I knocked the door, and this lady came from the top of the steps down, and I start to give her my usual
spiel.
Mm-hmm. She screamed back, says, "Mary, pots and pans man here, coming down." They took me upstairs. She was graduated from school that year, and she was going to get married in a couple of months. They were looking pots and pans.
Uh-huh.
I went through all my spiel and this and that, but she says, write the order.
Uh-huh.
I wrote the order. Cenk, you cannot believe it. From that day on, wherever I went, I sold. I start to sell at least 2-3 sets per week.
But why the difference? Like,
I don't know. Maybe it broke my, you know, self-confidence or something happened.
Uh-huh.
And the guy who owned that agency says, in the meetings, once a week we made the meeting, says, look at this guy. He barely speaks English. He sells 3 sets. You guys are born Americans. How come you can?
What is this, Glengarry Glen Ross? Did he knock the coffee out of their hands? So that's funny. When I briefly worked in sales about 17, 18 years ago in Miami, sold TV ad sales. I remember nothing felt better than getting a sale.
Yes.
I felt on top of the world whenever I got a sale.
I went to one house in Jersey City in one night around 6:30 or so. She had her other 3 friends that night staying in her house, you know, girls from same high school. And went I there, I walk away a couple hours later with 3 sets sale in one house.
Uh-huh. How much money was it?
That day, it was about, my commission was about $600.
Wow. Yes. Oh, that's real money back
then. Yes, it's a lot of money.
Oh, you must have floated on a cloud to back to home.
That's it, yeah.
You didn't need any transportation that night. Okay. So you go and you hustle and you do all this stuff. Okay, where do you meet my mom? What happens?
Oh, that's another interesting story. My mother gets ill.
Oh, I'm sorry, real quick, before you get to that. Was Frank Sinatra in Hoboken at the same time you were, or no?
Well, his house that where he was born was opposite to a boarding house I was staying in Hoboken. It was a two side of the street.
Mm-hmm.
And the bar, they had his picture, and he used to go there all the time, and everybody talks about him.
Okay, but you didn't Forrest Gump that. You didn't all of a sudden, oh, there's Frank Sinatra, and then I tell him something, and then he turns it into a song. No. Okay, all right. Okay, so, okay, your mom got sick. Okay, you hear. And this is at this point, you're in graduate school in America, or you graduated?
I was still studying. I graduated in 64. I got my master's degree. First, I was in a doctorate degree program, but later on, I said, I'm going to get my master's degree, and I'm going to go back to Turkey, and I'm going to start my own business. For that reason, I'm not going to continue anymore. But I was still working in Stevens as a research engineer. And I went to my hometown for a vacation, and my mom and all of the other relatives, and they showed me a couple of girls, and nothing worked out. And so I came back.
Hold on. People at home, they're showing you girls. What does that mean, they're showing you girls?
Well, they say this girl is very beautiful and coming from good family, and she's educated, this and that. And so they make an appointment with their family. So my family, we go to see their house, okay, sit their house. We drink our coffee, tea and everything. And she sits there, I sit there. And then family start to talk to each other. Is it going to be happening or not? A couple of trial didn't work out.
Okay, so let's call it what it is. These are arranged marriages.
Yes.
Okay, so there's no dating, none of that?
No.
Okay, so you're like, okay, my mom's sick, I need to get married.
Yes.
Okay.
No, I went to Turkey and I stayed with my mom for about a month. She was in hospital. Finally, she passed away.
Oh.
And from Ankara, I brought her back to Kilis.
Mm-hmm.
After funeral and everything is finished, I had only 10 days left to which I get the permit from my work that I had to go back to the United States to my work.
Mm-hmm.
And my relatives, they stormed on me. They said, your brother got married an American girl, and if you go back and you are going to get married an American girl, so we are not going to let you do it.
Well, now, it's not very open-minded of them, but I'm glad they did, because otherwise I wouldn't be around again.
Yeah.
So in 10 days, they got to find you a girl.
Yes, they did
find. I think there's a movie in here somewhere. We can make a movie out of this.
They did find somebody, and we had the real marriage already, officially marriage is done. We had a little meeting. We invite all the relatives and everybody, and we were officially married. But we didn't get married physically.
You didn't consummate the marriage.
No, yeah. Uh-huh. And so I got that piece of paper. I came to United States, and I applied for the visa for Nuket, my wife. And then when the visa is given to her, she came to United States with her mother 5 months later.
Okay, so hold on, though. You said that you had three girls to choose from?
Yes.
Before we got to
yes,
my mom?
Yes, yes.
Okay, you guys go and you have the coffee and the tea, and what happens for you guys to agree or not agree? What do you agree or not agree based on?
First of all, you see, my time was so compressed, and I didn't have the luxury to visiting all the girls.
Uh-huh.
They show me the girls and from on the street that's the girl. And I said,
okay,
how do you
like that? They're in the street. You want to marry that one? That one or that one?
I eliminated two of them.
Okay. Let's be honest. Let's call a spade a spade. Was it based on looks?
Well, look and the family as well.
Oh, okay. You want to marry into a good family because you want them to have been brought up right.
Yes.
So they teach your kids the right things.
Yes.
And stuff like that. That's why you're okay. All right.
And then my family was very, very keen on this Nuket's family because
my mom's family.
Yeah, uh-huh. Because it's a very well-known family in Kilis, very respected family in Kilis. Okay,
right, because they have land, and my grandfather's a dentist and well-known
yes.
and respected. He's the only dentist in town.
Yes, yes,
right.
Yes.
On my mom's side, obviously.
Yes, yes.
So, but Howard, you're from a much lower family. So, how are you going to marry into this upper family?
Well, the only reason they allow me to do that, there was a couple of things. First of all, my uncle's sons mm-hmm. and Nuket's uncle's son are best friends.
Okay, so you got a little bit lucky that they know each other from school or wherever.
From town, they know each other very well. They're like a brother, okay? Another thing, I'm a mechanical engineer, and I am in the United States, I have a car, I have a very...
Oh, at that point you have a car.
Yes,
oh,
yes,
okay,
yes, yeah. Everything. And another interesting thing, my mother-in-law was coming to Istanbul every summer, and my uncle's wife and her friends, they were getting together, and they keep talking about this guy. Doğan is doing this, Doğan is really very clever, and he's in technical university, he's... Very, taking care of our kids, and he's good, is that. And she was always listening, but she didn't know who I am and who this person they are talking
to.
So
that's a person on my mom's side of the family. Then she goes back home to Kilis, and she's got all this
yes.
Doğan propaganda about how good you
yes.
are from your family members.
Yes, yes.
So that winds up playing into it, too. But, okay, so because this would have been very hard for you, right?
Yes.
Some of your family members tried to talk you out of even asking for her, right?
Yes.
They're like, what? We're going to get embarrassed.
Yes,
they're
yes,
going to
yes,
say
yes.
your family's too low.
Yes, yes, yes.
We're not. No way. We're going to do arranged marriage with the lowly Uyghurs.
Yes, yes.
Who are you guys?
That's
right?
True. That's true.
Right. And so, and there's this cute story about how you guys go, and my grandmother locked herself out of the house accidentally. And
yeah,
then,
yeah, yeah.
And then your family members thought that's it. She locked us out.
Yeah, yeah. That's the first time they want to go to talk to her. And if she would be amicable for this kind of approach. And when they came, she was coming out of the home, and they told her what their purpose was, and they told that we have very short time. And she said, I'm sorry, I locked the door, and Nuket has the key because she's coming from school later, and she will open the door. I'm going to my friend's house to see her, and that's the reason I couldn't entertain you, I couldn't get you in. And then when this word come to my family, at that night, oh, of course, she had the key. But
she's not. She just wouldn't let you in the house. You're going to. And then what you had a really insistent aunt that said, no,
yes,
we're going to go back?
No. She said, no, you are wrong, and I'm going to go back tomorrow, and I'm going to do this.
Okay. And you guys go, And so because of all these different events that you described, a family that normally would not be allowed to marry into one of these families, they usually marry among themselves, some of the bigger families.
Things are starting to change that time because in 1950, the new government came in, democracy came into Turkey, and now those barriers start to crumble.
Like the old way of doing things and the old stratification of society.
That's right. And the rich person's son who didn't go to school and the other middle class or the lower class son is now engineer in United States, this and that, and so there's no competition anymore.
See, I never thought about it that way. I always talk on the show about how I'm part of the reason I'm a progressive is because you got that free education that allowed us to have all the things that, we have now in the world. But I never put two and two together and realized that if you didn't get that education, you never would have been able to marry my mom in the first place.
No,
I would never even exist.
That's true.
Right?
That's true.
So when you create this equality of opportunity, so many things blossom out of that that you couldn't possibly
predict. Definitely right.
Well, for my detractors, they're probably like, God damn it, why'd they give the free education away? We could have been rid of this guy. He would have never existed in the first place. Okay, so in that 10 days, you do this thing, somehow miraculously, they say yes.
Yes.
And then, but you, there was no wedding, there was no...
We had the little meeting, invite all the friends and family, and that's it.
Did you guys sing and dance?
Yeah, there was some singer or something, I don't remember, some music, I don't know.
And then I remember I saw a picture that when you guys came back to the U.S., you guys did like another informal wedding.
Maybe 10 friends. We invited, and then my brother and his wife, they came in.
And potato chips. And
Öyle, that's it.
That's it. Okay. Mm-hmm. So my poor mom never had a really big, nice wedding.
No, unfortunately.
Okay. You know, you guys have been married 50 years.
Yes.
You know, on the 50th year anniversary, you should have given her a real wedding. All right, 75th anniversary. Okay. So now she's in a foreign land. She doesn't speak English. Mm-hmm. She's got to learn English, yada, yada. Okay. So all of a sudden you're married, and there's this person you don't know anything about, and she's in your house.
Yeah.
So how was that? How did you guys get along?
Perfect. No problem at all.
So, hi, new kid, how you doing? I'm Dogan, and and this is our life from now on. Yeah. She's like, oh, okay.
Okay.
Yeah. And then you guys went about living life.
Yes.
It's amazing. It's amazing. Okay. All right. So, but at some point you moved back to Turkey.
Well, yes, from very early age, from childhood, and we keep talking among ourselves, the friends, Turkey is backward, cannot develop industry and cannot get rich like America or Europe. Why? We are trying to find the reason for it. And I, in my mind, I said, you know what? Turkey is not producing or manufacturing all the machinery that will do the manufacturing. Mm-hmm. So we have to really build our own production machinery in Turkey. Mm-hmm. That will give us impetus to open up the whole world. Mm-hmm. That was my idea. I developed in my mind.
Because you want to pay back Turkey for all the opportunity they
gave
you.
Yes.
Okay, that's great.
That was idealistic and childish, but yet it brought me here.
Okay, no, that's great. So now, we'll never get done with the story if we don't pick up speed here a little bit. But so I want to talk about a little bit about how you started your company, because that's really interesting, then how you moved back to the U.S., and then we'll wrap it up.
Okay.
If I take you all the way to 78 years old, we'll be here all night and maybe into tomorrow. Okay, yeah. So you go back to Turkey, but at that point, you have a little bit of money because you did sold the pots and pans.
Yes.
You had the tutoring, and you lived in America. So that's when you start your own company.
I have $17,000 when I went to Turkey.
Oh, wow. Okay. Yeah. All right.
Okay.
That's not bad. Not bad.
But I had to go to military service 2 years.
Oh, right. Because in Turkey it's compulsory.
Yes.
I forgot when you did the military service. So when you go back, you first do that.
Yes.
Okay.
And then once it's finished, I came back to Istanbul. I rent an apartment and I establish my company and I start the business. But everybody was asking me, what are you going to do? I'm going to build machinery. What machinery? Whatever. Mm-hmm. I'll build anything.
Yeah.
That's such a childish.
Yeah.
You know, when I'm thinking right now, it's almost impossible. I have no experience with the machinery building, and I have no idea what machine I'm going to build. Mm-hmm. And so I wind up being a partner with somebody who has a machine shop, and 50-50 we were partners. We built a couple machinery together, and then I keep asking all my friends who are working in different companies. I asked Arakan, my friend Arakan, and he said, you know what? There is a glass manufacturing company. They are now expanding the whole factory. They are mm-hmm. building the almost twice as much big factory. They will need a lot of machinery. Why don't you go to talk to them? I jump in and go to see the president of the company, and I said, what do you need? What kind of machinery do you need? He was smiling, and he says, okay, you can build any machinery? Yes. Okay, he said, come with me. He showed me a machinery, steel machinery this big, okay? So this is vibrating magnetic field, feeder, mm-hmm. electromagnetic vibrating feeder. Can you build that? That's not a problem at all.
You don't know how to build it, right?
Yeah, we need 45 of them. I said, that's it. I can do it. No problem.
No problem. So you go back to your empty office, right?
Well, I separated from that partnership, but mm-hmm. I still good relationship with him. Mm-hmm. And so I made a proposal, and they accept my proposal, and we got some down payment. Mm-hmm. And I brought, they give me one sample machine. I take apart that one. I copied everything, and I built 45 of those machines.
So the way that you could get it to the business started is he gave you the down payment. If he doesn't give you the down payment, you're not going to have enough money to build it.
Yes, that's right.
And he gave you a sample one, and that's how you jerry-rigged it and figured out how to build it. I believe that's called ingenuity.
Yes.
Right?
And so I built it, and we brought it back to the factory, and the guy said, because everybody is very suspicious, locally manufactured machinery. Oh, it's a garbage. It doesn't work.
Oh, they trust the Europeans. They trust the Americans.
Yes,
but they don't trust the Turks.
That's right.
In Turkey.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. And so we set up a set, and we put the machine, and we start to vibrate it. It doesn't move. Uh-huh. Everybody start to laughing. Ah, look at that. International Makine Sanayi doesn't work.
Yeah, this fancy international mechanical industry, whatever. Yes.
But from headquarters of the company, there was an engineer. He came to me, he said, these people are terrible. Mm-hmm. I've been following you. You are a very honest, very hardworking person. You can do this. I said, how am I going to do it? I don't have any money, mm-hmm. and I don't know what's wrong with it, why it's not working. I mm-hmm. copied exactly the same. He said, pick up everything, bring back your shop, mm-hmm. and we'll figure out. Mm-hmm. So I brought a big truck and put everything and take it back to our shop. I'm saying, why it's not working? I remember we have a teacher, professor, taught us vibration when I was in college. Mm-hmm. I'm going to go to talk to him. I went to see him, and I drove a little sketch mm-hmm. of the mechanism working. He asked one question, did you measure the deflection of the springs? All of a sudden, whole thing opened up. I said, thank you. And he was trying to still tell me something. I just rushed out of the room. I came in because there is this big flat springs, mm-hmm. steel springs. And in Europe, they brought it. Has only 6 flat springs. Mm-hmm. And I made the exact size, exact thickness and everything, 6 springs. But mm-hmm. I didn't realize that springs, they have a different deflection if they heat treated differently. Mm-hmm. And so I came in, I measured the deflection on the original one, and I made a calculation. I put that amount of springs. Machine started screaming crazy. Mm-hmm. Okay, I find the solution, but I don't have the money. Mm-hmm. I went back to the engineer. I said, look, I solved the problem. Machine is working properly. If you want to come to see it, by all means. But I don't have any money. I said, okay. When I was in college, one of my professors was vice president of that big company that I was doing the business with. That engineer took me to his office. He said, you may remember, Dogan was your student. I don't think he remembered, but he said, oh, yeah. And we told him the story. He said, that's okay. We'll fix it. I said, how? How many machines you can do on your own without any money? I said, maybe four or five of them. Okay, go to finish them, bring them, and get the paper from acceptable from the factory, and I'll pay you the 50% of that machinery. And I did that in three, four times. That's it. Everything. And then next morning, I would sit down and design a brochure. I'm the most biggest manufacturer of vibrating magnetic.
Look at this guy's marketing immediately. It reminds me of a kid who didn't know what the hell he was doing and started a show in his living room and decided it was going to be the biggest news show in the world.
Yes. And I was very big, very big brochure. And I started to send everyone and start to visit the companies. And one thing led to the other. Before we know, I had a factory, 46 people working. And
was it all the vibrating machines, or now you're making different machines?
No. We added the magnetic lifting magnets, 3 meter diameter lifting magnets, lifting one time 20 ton of steel.
All this you built from scratch?
Everything, everything. Not only design, material that time was impossible to import from Europe or the United States. Because it was the government didn't have enough foreign exchange. Even though you pay the government money, it takes a year or sometimes year and a half to get the material in back to Turkey. So what they did, anything we need, I smuggle into Turkey.
Oh, okay, that's good. edit this out. So you got all the bureaucracy you got to fight through.
Yes.
You had to figure out how to make these damn things.
Yep.
Then you got to convince Turks that it's okay to buy from a fellow Turk. The machine's going to work.
Yep.
Right? Because they don't. You go through all this, and eventually you got 46 people working for you. And then you sold it, right?
Yeah. First, I sold the 50%. And then we enlarged it, and we became really full-fledged manufacturers. And then things get so bad in Turkey. End of 70s, beginning of 70s to the end of 70s, it was really terrible. Right wing and
left wing,
they were fighting on the streets of Istanbul, Ankara. They were killing each other. And I, and my factory's wall, outside wall, they read, "Boss, your days are numbered."
Oh, wow.
Yes.
So your workers?
Yes.
Because
I don't know if my workers or somebody else, because outside wall, it says the boss, your days are out.
Are those literally communists in those days?
Yes. They were hardcore communists. But the opposite side was completely right-winger, stupid jerks. They keep killing each other mercilessly.
And so you don't know if it's your own workers or somebody else agitating, but they're coming after the capitalists.
Yes.
And at that point, you find yourself as a capitalist.
Yeah.
Even though
I called the guy who was heading my group of workers. I called him in my office. Look, I said, here we have 46 people, very poor families. This is the only way they can bring bread to their families. And you see my car? It's a junk. And I'm coming here before you guys come, and I go after you go. So why do you want to? You are supposed to be fighting with the huge big corporation. Let me alone. And he said, okay, if you give me all my legal money when I leave, and I will go. I said, come on. I called the accountant. I said, give him whatever he wants. Let him go. He did go. And 10 days or 15 days later, they called from Turkish secret agency. That like a MIT, we call MIT, but in like a
That's
CIA.
That's like the CIA. Okay.
CIA. And they said, so-and-so is what used to work for you? And he says, yet. And how much money did you give it to him when he left? He said, about 18,000 Turkish liras. He says, why are you keep asking all these questions? Oh, this is the police, and we caught him in a communist organization. He had 50,000 Turkish liras and two gun in his possession. And he told us that he got everything from International Makine Sanayi.
Huh. Yes. So this crazy guy who was leading the workers in your place turned out to be a crazy communist guy.
Yeah.
And he's got a couple of weapons. And
that day, as soon as I heard that, I came home and I said, Nikhat, we are going. He says, where? We are going to America. That's it. I'm not going to stay here anymore.
Oh, you see, I thought you panicked needlessly because there was a little bit of fighting in the streets.
No.
The guys are in your own factory, with their guns and stuff, and you're like, we got to go.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Well, that makes sense. So then you sell the business, you come here.
Yeah.
And so the last part of the story is you buy a building here, right?
Mm-hmm.
Why did you buy a building? You were an engineer. So you're in New Jersey.
In New Jersey. I bought the house. I rent the car.
Because your brother's in New Jersey, so you go to New Jersey.
Yes.
That makes sense.
Yes, yes.
Okay, you get here. You got a little bit of money that you got from from selling your business.
Yes.
Okay, so why a building?
Well, my first attempt was to buy a small machine shop or some kind of technical company to enlarge it and really make it well. But then I look at it, many companies, almost 7 months, I look different companies, and if it's real good, they are asking astronomical numbers. And if it's really terrible, you know that's not going to make money. So finally, I didn't know what to do, and I was eating my Campbell complaint continuously. So finally, one of my friends from high school, and he was in New Jersey, he was in real estate.
So from your hometown of Kilis, that little town, he happens to be in New Jersey as well.
Yes.
He's in real estate, and he talks you into this thing?
Yeah, Coldwell Banker. He was working for Coldwell Banker. And he said, there is this office building, 50,000 square feet in middle Eatontown, and it's really cheap, dirt cheap, and we can buy it. It's no time. We can make a lot of money. So
did that turn out to be true?
No.
Shocking. It turns out it was hard to get rich quick.
But 50,000 square feet building, only one third is rented, and they were paying unbelievably low. Total gross income of the monthly income of the building was about $5,000.
Mm-hmm.
Expenses of building was about $20,000 a month.
So you're losing $15,000 a month on top of what you paid for the building?
Yes.
Okay. Did you get in a fight with your friend?
No, it was too late because I was in the middle of it.
So you didn't know what you were getting yourself into?
No.
Here we go again. You didn't know what you were getting yourself into when you start the manufacturing business, now this. So how'd you get out of this hole?
I have one thing that I will tell every single kid, disadvantaged families, and everybody, you never give up. You work until all the barriers are open. I realized after I bought the building, I came in and I made a little office for myself, and I look at all the leases. My God, this is really terrible. This is going to kill all my money. Everything will be gone and I will be in trouble. I will go bankrupt. I start to read all the leases, which I never read the lease before. And every day I start to come 7:30, 8 o'clock until 6, 7 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
Saturdays included.
Mm-hmm.
One of the leases was for one of the biggest tenant, which was a private school. Okay? In that lease, there was a clause. It says, if this building is sold, the new owner can renegotiate the lease. I said, that is something unusual. That's beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
Is it true? I took to one of the lawyers, he said, yeah, that's right. Mm-hmm. So I wrote a letter to the people. They were occupying almost 25-30% of the building, and they were paying something like $3,400 a month. It's impossible.
Mm-hmm.
I wrote them a letter and said, that's it. Either you get out of the building, which it is a big risk, because if they get out, I'm in trouble. I'm finished. or I'm increasing your monthly rent to that time around 6,800 or something like that, maybe almost twice as much. He said, you are crazy. I said, okay, it's your term, you do it. He took me to court.
Okay, this is a high-stakes poker for you.
Yes.
Because if they leave, you're in a world of hurt.
No, they couldn't leave because they have laboratories and this and that. It's not easy.
Ah, I see.
Even the new money I'm offering them is still too cheap.
Got you. Uh-huh.
Okay. I mean, I calculated everything.
Right.
Okay. So they said, okay, finally, there is no way they can get out of it. They accept it. And then I start to increase others. And then my friend, because of his real estate broker, he said, I'll rent it everything. Don't worry about anything. And I'm a Rotarian. I went to Eatontown Rotary Club. And one older gentleman said, you look to me not from this town. Where are you from? I said, I'm from Turkey, but I bought this building, one main street here. Oh, that Turkish guy you are, huh? Okay, come here, sit down. On the bar, we are talking. He said, how are you going to rent that space? Because that is empty last 10 years. We call that green elephant. I mean, white elephant. Mm-hmm. I said, my friend is a broker and a Colbert banker, and he said he's going to rent it in no time. He said, bullshit. He said, there is a newspaper in town called the Asbury Park Press. Tomorrow morning, you are going to get one of them and small advertisement section. Look for the other business people, how they, for the building rental, they put the advertisement. You look at that and you make your own advertisement and put it there. Don't take it out, even if your building is completely full. Mm-hmm. I listened to him. Next morning, I put it. And 20 years, I did not remove that ad.
And it totally worked.
Totally worked.
By back the time, when this is sold, is that newspaper ads used to work back then?
Yes. When I sold it 20 years later, building was bringing in $60,000 a month.
What was it when you bought it?
$5,000.
From $5,000 to $60,000?
Yes.
Yeah, wow. And I remember you made good money on that.
And there wasn't a single square foot of vacant space when I sold it.
And that paid for, you know, our life in East Brunswick, New Jersey for 20, 30 years.
No.
It paid for my college education.
Everything, everything. Yeah. And then with that money, I bought 5 shopping centers.
Uh-huh. Small strip malls.
Strip malls, yes.
Yeah.
And I renovated 3 of them brand new. Mm-hmm. And I turned around, I sold those things twice as much what I bought for.
That's why I call you the American dream, right? This is exactly what they say you're supposed to do, right?
Yes.
Work hard, get an education, build your business, be an entrepreneur, you know, and you did, and you got bigger and bigger, and you lived a good life, right?
Yes, thank God, yes. And starting from nothing in my hometown and coming here and buying buildings and, you know, manufacturing machinery in Turkey, these are all one thing I owe all these things. That hard work in my hometown from my childhood teach me to endure all kind of difficulties, all kind of hard work. I didn't give up. No matter what, I didn't give up. And that's the reason my message to young people, don't make excuses. There is 1,000 excuses always. You keep going right direction. Try to find this way, that way, until you really pass the other side and open your road and go.
So that's interesting. You know, I've heard these different stories at different times throughout my life. Some of them I've heard, some of them I haven't heard. But now that I've heard it in one big sitting, I want to summarize. I think that it wasn't just hard work. It was a number of things, right? So one, opportunity. Mm-hmm. And if you didn't get the free education, you don't have the opportunity, you're done for,
yes.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
You're still back in Kilis with your 20 olive trees, right? Two is hard work and relentlessness,
yes.
Okay? It's super important. You can't do it without that,
right?
And so both of those things are necessary. The hard work by itself is not enough. You need the opportunity. Mm-hmm. And the opportunity by itself is not enough. You need to add in the hard work. Number three is, as you tell the story, I'm amazed by how many people helped you when they didn't need to help you.
Yeah.
You know, your professors, that the one that taught you the vibrating, the other one that gave you the money, your ex-professors, yes. right? Mm-hmm. Your family that put you up in their house in Istanbul, yeah. your cousins, right? Your brother, obviously, who taught you the way and then brought you here.
Without him, I wasn't impossible for me to be here.
The Rotarian who guided you into putting the ad in the yes. newspaper, and all the different people who opened you with welcome arms in America, yeah, right? Yeah. So it's, and you're a self-made man. You're the the most prototypical self-made man, and it turns out you weren't just made by yourself, right?
Yeah.
Right. So we work together, we create opportunity, and then we put the roll up our sleeves.
But the same thing we did with you when on the one summer I told you to maybe buy foreclosure houses, and you really put yourself in, and we bought the first house with you, and then in 2 years we bought and sold 30 houses. 30 houses.
Yeah, I forget that it was 30. That's a lot.
Yeah, it's a lot.
So, yeah, my dad is as his way, as you might be able to tell by now. My junior year at Penn, instead of getting a regular job, he says, we're going to do this foreclosure business. We don't know how to do it. So it's never stopped him before, right, when you don't know anything. Right. So he threw me into the fire, and I went around and I asked people, how do I do this? How do I value a house? How do I check its mortgages, and we figured it out together. And that summer, I think we bought 3 houses,
yeah.
mm-hmm. right? And eventually 30 houses. And so anything is possible, and you taught me that, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
So when I'm that crazy kid in the living room here in LA, and I decide I'm going to start a radio show and then build it into the largest news show, I think anything's possible,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
Add an opportunity, which you gave me, right? And this country gave me. Add in hard work, and then ask people for help. Right.
Yep.
Whether it was Ben, who started the show with me, didn't get paid. Right.
Yeah.
Yep. Dave Kohler, my friend from childhood,
yes.
who drove across the country, quit his job at a good company, which we thought was a good company, AIG back then.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And helped build this from the ground up. And then Jesus and JR, who came in as interns, worked for free in the beginning.
I remember.
Right.
Yeah.
So it takes a village.
Yep.
Right.
That's right.
Whether that village is, you know, the village in New York City, West Hollywood here, you know, where we first started, or in Kilis. So, look, we can go on forever. I can ask you about, the kids and grandkids and stuff. Maybe we'll do that another time. But I wanted people to get a sense of how you got here,
yeah.
right? And how somebody goes from a little patch of land, a tiny patch of land in a little town in small southeastern Turkey, to where you are today, and I think we got that sense, and I want to thank you. I want to thank you for doing the interview, and I want to thank you for everything I have.
Well, my message to all the young people or everybody, don't give up. You have to work hard, and you have to be continuously thinking, how can I improve it? How can I improve it? That is going to get you where you want to go.